motivated.
Get motivated.
Get motivated. Hip hop motivated. Blowing wisdom on the mic with Sean Anthony.
Get motivated.
Get it right with Sean Anthony.
Get motivated. Get motivated.
Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. We are joined by special guest Brandon Turbeville, breaking down Syria.
Let's go. Let's get into this article, Sanctions in Syria, an exclusive look at how everyday people are paying the price. Now, I want to read an excerpt out of this article to paint the picture for those that are listening. You traveled over there. So let me just get into it because it explains everything. It says, in 2017, I visited Syria. I sat in Damascus and listened to the sounds of mortars, missiles, and gunfire ring out 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. At night, I would walk to the roof of the hotel and watch the firefight raging in Jabar. Damascus residents, innocent civilians, lived in constant fear of terrorist mortars that would rain down on them randomly. Sometimes destroying their homes, sometimes killing their neighbors or family members. Sometimes, if they were lucky, they would only land in the street, scaring the shop owners and their customers and sending the street cats for the nearest hiding place. Sometimes, however, it would be the last thing they would hear. And sometimes it would be the last thing their children would hear. Now, of course, Brandon, when you fast forward, go through this article, you talk about the difference was when you went in 2019, but back in 2017, as you described in this article, put it to words. Let us hear you verbally express what it was like for you, your first time visiting Syria in 2017.
Well, it's a contrast, right? Because Syria is a beautiful place. And the people are beautiful, and they're so welcoming and kind. And when I came into Syria the first time, I was told that Syrians like Americans, and honestly, I didn't believe it because, you know, after what it was 6 years of war, I figured that they would not be very welcoming of me at least. But when I got there, I saw that wasn't true. I met some of the kindest people that I've ever met. We walk down the street and people would come up to us and say, "Are you American?" And when I say yes, they'd invite us into their homes or their shop for tea and sweets, and they'd want to talk with us. If they couldn't speak English very well, they'd try as best they could with broken English or a translator on the phone, or they'd go get their friend that spoke English, and they'd bring that person out and we try to talk. And these people had very little because of 6 years of war, and still they would give us gifts. Mm. You know, and I went to shops that were struggling because of the war and the sanctions, and this man insisted that I take these things as gifts and wouldn't take no for an answer, right? And so it was very touching to be there. Yes, they did. They do love Americans, not the military and not the government, but American people. They were that way with everyone who I traveled with. In Damascus, I mentioned it in the article, it was mortars and bombs and random gunfire all day, every day. Random times, you could be walking down the street and the mortar would explode and that'd be the last thing you would hear, right? It was randomly targeting civilians, and a lot of people had lost their lives that way. Not just even during the height of the war, but there was a neighborhood named Jabar, and this was the last stronghold of terrorists in the Damascus city area. And so you could go to the roof of the hotel, and at night you could see it with the tracers and all that. You could see the gunfire on the roof of the hotel. And watched that. And the people that you would talk to were resilient, but had an understanding and an appreciation for life that I've never seen anywhere else. And part of me, I don't know if it's Syria or if it's the fact that maybe that's what happens when you're at war.
Mm-hmm.
It's something I don't see over here. And maybe we would see that over here if we were in that situation.
Right. So that's got to be unsettling for you, Brandon, because prior to that, you haven't, and correct me if I'm wrong, you haven't been in that kind of environment before where you're hearing bombs going off and innocent civilians being randomly targeted by missiles.
Yeah, that was the first time that I've been in a war zone like that. And
how tense was it for you? Could you sleep at night?
Yeah, actually, I did sleep. There would be bombs that would be so loud it would wake you up. But yeah, I slept, and you certainly don't need coffee, right? you're awake when you're out there.
Did you fear for your life?
Not really. Anything can happen at any time, but really anything can happen anywhere. Keep in mind, I was there for a couple weeks, so there was an end date for me, and that's the other thing. If I went there and things got hairy, then I had 2 weeks, and I was home. But the people that I met, it may go on for another 20 years. It may never end for them. They don't know, so you have to live with that every day.
Wow. That's something. Do you think, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Brandon.
We sat with people, and as they were talking, the bombs were falling, right? And they were telling me about their experiences. And we met a girl who, she was a teenager when the war started. She lost her entire family. She had no relatives left. And this was a time when she should have been learning to drive a car and get a driver's license and, try to drink beer and behind her parents' back and all this kind of stuff. She was not doing that. She was burying her family and literally trying to survive and not get beheaded until she made it to Damascus and was taken in by some friends. So these were stories. You could talk to anybody in Syria and you would get stories just like that. There were just absolute horror stories where we went through Khan al-Assal, where they had taken the town baker and baked him alive in an oven.
Mm.
This was the terrorists doing this. Now, just for people who don't know, it was not the Syrian government. It was the terrorists that were funded to do this. The most brutal, inhumane things were done to these people. And the people that you talk to generally lost somebody in a very brutal, horrific fashion. There was one person who had their daughter was kidnapped, and a terrorist came to them and demanded a ransom, something unreasonable, like, $200,000, and of course they didn't have any of that money and no way to get it. As they told them that they would kill her if they didn't give them the money, and obviously they didn't have the money. They tried everything they could to reason with the terrorist faction. So they took her out and they cut her apart piece by piece in front of her family.
Oh my gosh! Oh.
And we could go on and on. We won't. But we could go on and on. This was stuff that we heard day in and day out.
And let the media tell us, they're saying that this is Assad and the Syrian government, right? Talk about how the people that you interacted with on Syrian land, how they genuinely feel about Assad and the Syrian government.
I haven't met one who didn't support their government. Now keep in mind, this doesn't mean that they're uncritical.
Right.
Of course, they're critical. They think things could be done better. Some of them might not even like Assad, right? They may think that another guy could do the job better. But they are 100% from the people that I talk to in support of their government. And if you ask them, well, what do you want the United States to do? And the answer is get out, go home, and stop funding and arming terrorists, plain and simple. And that was the answer we got every single time. Now, I know what people are going to say. Oh, yeah, you went to Syria and you talked to Syrians with their police state. You know, people were scared to death to speak out. Well, I was in Lebanon, and I spoke to a lot of Syrians in Lebanon, right? Every one of them said the same thing. And they weren't living under the Syrian government. They were in Lebanon. So that argument doesn't hold water. I talked to people inside Syria, and I talked to people outside Syria. And they all told me the same thing.
Hold that thought. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and we're going to come back and continue the conversation with Brandon Turbeville, Breaking Down Syria. I am Sean Anthony, and this is Flow of Wisdom. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. We are joined by special guest Brandon Turbeville, Breaking Down Syria.
Brandon, I'm not going to take too much more of your time. Obviously, you're very knowledgeable on this subject. You've written books about it and hundreds of articles on the subject matter. But real quick, what is it that draws you to Syria? What is it, because you've been covering Syria for years, and you know, you've been on this platform, Flow of Wisdom, many, many times, talking about it and bringing things to the forefront that we normally wouldn't see or hear in other media outlets. What is it that draws you to the country Syria?
Yeah, that's a hard question. I've been asked that, and I've had fellow researchers and journalists ask themselves the same question, and nobody can really come up with a good answer. It's a special place, and there is something special about it, and I can't exactly tell you what it is. I was writing about it and obsessed with it before I ever went. A lot of these other people were also, and I honestly can't answer the question. I'm not fully sure, but it's a special place, absolutely.
Well, Brandon, I want to give this opportunity to you to promote, to talk about anything you got coming up, any special projects that you want the public to know about. Feel free to share how they can get in contact with you as well. The floor is yours, Brandon Turbeville.
Yeah, well, if they're interested in learning about the history of this war, I would encourage them to read my book, Resisting the Empire, and you can buy that on Amazon. And it's hundreds of pages. It's about 400 pages worth of information. I jam-packed all that information in there so people can go, and when they finish the book, they'll know how it started, why it's happening, who all the players are, and all that. It was published in 2016, so it's a few years behind. But they can always go to my website, BrandonTurbeville.com, and there's tons of articles there about Syria, and they can go to the search bar and if they're interested in a specific subject, they can look it up there. I've covered most of the stuff that's happened there. As for future projects, I don't really have anything planned. I'm just writing articles as they come to me now. At one point I was doing articles probably 10 times a week at least, and now I'm just kind of doing them as they come, and hopefully they'll be worth the extra time. But BrandonTurbeville.com is where I put all the articles that I do, and people should just follow me there. And there's a link to my Twitter. It's at Brandon Turb. They can follow me on Twitter, and they can find me on Facebook also. So I do a little social media, and I try to post things here and there also.
Brandon, I just want to take this opportunity publicly to say thank you. You have always came through for me whenever I needed you to come on the show to talk about a particular subject matter, even in the early days, whether it was about chemtrails or, anything in between that and Syria. I mean, you're someone that I can genuinely call a friend. You know, and like I said at the beginning of the show, you know, it's really rare that you have this rapport with people that, you know, that are in the trenches, you know, that are putting in the work, and you're able to develop a relationship over many, many years. A lot of times you'll have I'll have a guest on and I'll never hear from them again. You know, I guess that's what I'm trying to say. So it's not really an anomaly. It's not rare. But, you know, to the extent that you and I have built our bond over the years, I just want to say thank you, man. And publicly, you know, that let everyone know I appreciate you, Brandon, and I appreciate all of the work that you.
Well, I appreciate those kind words, Sean. The feeling's mutual. I really do appreciate you having me on all these years, and you've been a big supporter of my work. And, you know, I can call you a friend also, and I appreciate that very much. I, as I mentioned earlier, I haven't done an interview in a long, long time, but this is the only show I've done in 2019. So.
Wow. Well, fast forward, it's 2020 now, and Happy New Year's to you, Brandon, and all the best to you, my friend. I'll talk to you soon.
Same to you. Thanks for having me on again.
All right, buddy.
We're going to take a quick commercial break, and we're going to come back and continue the conversation with Brandon Turbeville, Breaking Down Syria. I am Sean Anthony, and this is Flow of Wisdom.
Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio.
Of course, I'm your host, Sean Anthony, and I wanted to do an impromptu interview with two gentlemen whom I know and work with here at the media school. Both of these guys are former military personnel. Behind me, Michael Thomas and Joski Love. But you can drop the love. Michael, you tell my people what your history is.
United States Army, 10 and a half years, highest rank reached E6 promotable. So, and I've deployed 5 times, 4 to Iraq, 1 to Afghanistan.
Joe, let people know what.
Work history or military history? Military.
Military
history. Military. So I was served in the U.S. Army. I was airborne field artillery for 5 years. Where I got out, my highest rank was E4. Just one deployment to Afghanistan for 15 long.
And you also, did you say airborne?
Airborne.
Okay. So Michael and I had a conversation probably 2 or 3 weeks ago, real in-depth conversation. And then we were just talking here and I was like, guys, please let's stop. I want to capture this. So that we can, you know, get this on my Flow of Wisdom platform. Michael, when I first came to you, when we had that discussion a few weeks ago, I asked you, I was told by a former military vet, that Fallujah was the most dangerous place in the world that he ever been to. And you attested to that, right? You said you were in Fallujah. Share the story you told me, what you had to do when you go to clear a building, what you had to do.
I think you're alluding to the story of when we lost our first person on the team. Essentially what happened was, you know, we walked in, we essentially did building clears in Fallujah. We had a total of 75 clears with one casualty. The one casualty that we're talking about now is there was a 19-year-old young man. My team went in through the back window in a building after getting indirect fire. And one of my guys hurt his ankle. We cleared the first couple of rooms. We got him out behind the line. And once that happened, we were given a young man who had never been in combat, brand new into country. And I was told that he was a soldier. He would catch up. And I told the leaders at that time that my team was very, we were very organized. We'd already done, I think at that time, 20 or 25 clears, and we were very successful in what we did. They told me he's a soldier, he'll catch on. They put him in my group. So we went into the next building to continue clearing, and first floor we got three engagements. He got his first kill on that first floor. Once that first kill happened, we have a situation where when you shoot your first person, there's a thing that can happen called bloodlust, and you sort of get amped up, adrenaline starts pumping, you don't think clearly, you're just caught in the moment, and unless you can break that, a lot of stupid things happen. And so he decided to go up to the second floor with us, kicking a door ahead of the breach, and had three banana clips emptied into him. We waited for the all clear, and then we sort of went in there and neutralized the room, and then we had to have him, his remains taken. He got medevaced. He didn't make it to the hospital.
Now let's back up a little bit, man, because I remember when we had this conversation before, and I was like, you know, civilians, most of them, we can't fathom what you guys go through and what you see in the heat of battle. And let's go back to that a little bit, because I think that you know, the more that this is exposed, maybe people have a greater appreciation, not to say that most people don't. But how does one prepare for something like that? One, and then two, how do you adjust? Because you said one or two things could happen. You have this thing called bloodlust, mm-hmm. you know, where you don't think clearly, but
or you adjust.
How do you adjust to seeing war, carnage?
Really, to tell you the truth, man, there's no like adjustment cycle. Like, they don't desensitize you to death. It's just there's a certain resiliency that's born out of training. And what happens is the military trains you to be the best that you can be in a situation, but they train you a lot on muscle memory. So what happens is when things happen, your fight or flight doesn't exist. It's just fight. So you learn how to just adjust, and it just happens. And some people aren't, they just don't do it. Sometimes, you know, you'll have a situation happen and it doesn't go the way it's supposed to, and you have to go. And so it's counterintuitive to the way you're trained, but really you're groomed to be the best that you can. And you just hope that when everything hits the fan that you react the way you should.
Is it easy for you guys to talk about this right now?
Nah, I mean, I'm good right now. It depends on how many stories and things we go into, but right now I'm okay with this.
Can I ask, and Joe, you could jump in anytime too. Can I ask you what was your first kill? Like, do you remember that, or do you feel comfortable?
Yeah, I mean, I've talked about it enough to where I can talk about it a little bit. We were on a convoy, MSR Tampa. We're getting ready to cross over the border. And as we were coming over the border into Iraq, we had a mud hut. And out of the mud hut, a young man was running. And the young man was strapped with C4 explosives on his body. And there was an older gentleman in the shack that was with the detonator, waiting for me to close enough. As a gun truck or as a roving gun truck, it's my responsibility to stop anything that would come and hinder or cause it damage to us. So I remember the day. I remember everything. I mean, the from when you pull the trigger to the round chambering to it getting hit by the firing pin, the round going down the barrel out.
So everything slowed down?
Everything slowed down. I could hear everything. I felt everything. I saw everything. When that when that young man got hit. And you know, I was on a big gun, so you know, it really wasn't that much left. And then we had the choice of either leaving that dilapidated vest with the hope of, you know, it's been stopped, or we neutralize the other side of it. And so we took care of the other half of that, which was the man in the hut. So I mean, that's pretty much.
How long did that situation last?
Seemed like, you know, minutes, but it was probably really fast. I mean, once you get a call to do what you need to do, it is pretty much, it's pretty quick. And
so let me just so I can think visually, you guys were in a vehicle.
Yep.
And this young person comes up in the middle of the road.
No, he's running out of the shack towards the road. We're on a convoy, so we're, what, 45, 50 vehicles deep?
Wow.
So the it could have disabled lots of vehicles and put us in a lot of situations. So
in a similar situation in Afghanistan, I luckily enough wasn't on it, but we saw a video. We talked to the guy that was part of it that were out on a convoy. They were out actually on what we call the road clearing package. So they were out trying to find IEDs for other convoys to come through so they wouldn't get hurt. And they stopped in the village to talk to some of the village elders. And as they were coming back through on their way home, they had to come through a more of a rural area of Afghanistan, not so out in the middle of nowhere, not so small villagey, but more of a city kind of thing. And as they were doing so, somebody walked out and walked right up into the middle of the road, right in front of the convoy. Now, in this situation, we were a little bit further into our deployment and into like Operation Enduring Freedom and Iraqi Freedom, probably compared to where he was at his deployment. So it was very early. Earlier in the deployments, you had a little bit more freedom to do things that you needed to do. When I was there, we had more structured things, more, you had what you call an escalation of force, you had to follow. And when we were there, you weren't allowed to shoot unless shot at. You had to get permission after you were shot at. So you fired without getting permission, you could be held lawful, just like here in the States, for killing somebody. So, you know, at this time, the gentleman walked out and stopped the convoy. Well, the convoy, you know, stopped far enough back, but apparently they kind of had watched this happen before. And what had happened is that they got the convoy to stop. They stopped probably about 100, 150, 200 feet away from this person. They were giving him commands, trying to get our interpreter to tell him what to do. Somebody else came out of a building back by the convoy, and it was a suicide bomber in the vest. And he blew up right next to the convoy. And luckily, no one was killed. And the U.S. services, a couple of civilians were hurt, and obviously the bomber was gone. I mean, literally there were pieces of him everywhere. But I will never forget the convoy rolling back in, and the Humvee that the bomber attacked personally. I'll never forget seeing just one whole side of it, nothing but black. And at that time, they had already learned, so you know, the windows were only this big, but they're like quadruple pane windows. So I mean, they're like that thick, and you see ball bearings just stuck in the glass.
Jeez.
And
from the impact.
Because he had ball bearings in his vest, and when he set it off, they went out like shrapnel, like a claymore mine, to get whatever they could, and they were just stuck in the Humvee. I mean, all over, there's spots where you can see it hit the Humvee, where they're stuck in the window, even in the crow's nest where the turret or the gunner. Luckily, the gunner had realized that the guy was there and had ducked underneath the shielding right as it went off, so he didn't get killed, but he got injured. But there was still, like, the whole thing. This is a tan Humvee that is now just one whole side of it is black. And, I mean, like I said, we saw video and pictures of it where the guy, I mean, he's here, he's there, right behind you.
It's crazy. So let me ask this last question. I don't want to break this up.
Hold that thought. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and we're going to come back and continue the conversation. I am Sean Anthony, and this is Flow of Wisdom. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony.
Last question. Were you ever in Fallujah?
I wasn't there. I was part of Operation Enduring Freedom, which is more Afghanistan. Okay. And when you compare, the funny thing is, like, everyone talks about going to Iraq, and I have friends that went to Iraq. Fallujah is most definitely the most dangerous place there.
All right, so that's what I want to close on.
Now, in Afghanistan, we were in the most dangerous place in Afghanistan, which was the Kunar province.
Kunar?
Yes.
Okay. Why was that? And I want to ask you the same question. Why was Kunar the most dangerous? What made that the most dangerous?
Well, we didn't just have to deal with, like, what, you know, a typical civilian would call a terrorist. Okay. We didn't just deal with those facts. They have warlords over there. They have guys that run areas of those countries illegally, because the number one crop, the number one source of income in Afghanistan is the growth of poppy, right. Poppy fields, which they use to make morphine, and then the byproduct of that is used to make heroin. So unfortunately, that's their number one crop. So they have a lot of guys out there that are running areas to grow these, to do what we know is illegal in our country. But what they do is they end up running people. We actually had a gentleman who worked on the FOB that we were at in our first half of our deployment that had a family. And at one point, he stopped coming to work. Come to find out, this warlord had actually kidnapped his wife and daughter and threatened to kill them if he didn't try to do something to us. We weren't just fighting like the typical terrorists. Right. We were out there fighting a lot of things. And at the time, Kunar, I mean, we were 3 miles off the Pakistan border. So people would attack us and then hop over the border, and there was nothing we could do. So, I mean, but I'll say this. My whole time over there, I realized a couple of things. One is, you know, people in Afghanistan, I'm one of the few people who will say this, and he'll probably turn around and want to smack me for it, but I had gotten to go to Iraq with some of my friends, just because I could have experienced what they did.
Say that again?
Exactly. Most people, like,
I didn't hear it.
I just wish I had gotten to go to Iraq with some of my friends, like, just because being able to compare the two.
You want
like,
to?
I don't know what Iraq's like. I know what people have told me, and I know what I've seen. I know what I was trained for, because I was originally supposed to go to Iraq. However, like, I know there's big differences, too. You know, Iraq, in a lot of the places that we're fighting, is very, like, city-like, very rural. Whereas Afghanistan's very open, very wildlifey. You're in the mountains. One moment you're down on a riverbed with rocks. The next moment you are 3,000 feet in the air on a mountain, climbing the side of it to try and chase somebody down. You're in a cave, and then you might be in somebody's backyard.
That's crazy. So, last question, Mike, why was Fallujah the most dangerous place?
I think a lot of the things that we had was learning our enemy. You know, it was so much carnage in Fallujah. There was so much, like, indirect firefights. There's just so much. Kind of messed me up with the last question. There's just so much loss there. There's so much strategic positionings that were happening there. And I think that it was just a lot of guerrilla warfare. And that guerrilla warfare just took that Battle of Fallujah to the next level, because we never knew where our enemy was coming from, but we knew that they were out there. And every turn we had another battle. Every new building we had to clear. Every new everything. We were experiencing everything in its totality at that point. And for a lot of us, it was the first time we were ever in war. So it was something that that you can't replace. The civility lost in war.
They always kept trying to throw these three words at you every time before you left the wire to go outside of the FOB or wherever you're staying. They always kept saying hearts and minds, because you don't realize that you're actually creating your enemy. Like, there were already people out there that were fighting against us, but those people have family, those people have friends, and when you take one of those people out, you're actually affecting the people around them, and you're creating your own enemy. But that's why when you went out, you tried to treat everyone like, okay, I'm not here to hurt you, I'm here to help you, but at the same time, you have to protect yourself. When it comes down to it, I mean, you make that decision, is it me or is it you?
Well, thanks for your time, guys. We're going to break this up. We are going to continue this conversation, but I appreciate you guys watching.
I am Sean Anthony, and this is Flow of Wisdom.
Motivated, get motivated, get motivated, get motivated, hip-hop motivated, flowing.